गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन,
गुड मॉर्निंग,
वेरी वार्म वेलकम. गुड मॉर्निंग, एम आई ऑडिबल? कुड यू कैन यू प्लीज जस्ट पुट येस और नो इन द चैट बॉक्स इफ आई एम ऑडिबल और नॉट. येस, थैंक यू सो मच अमोल सर, थैंक यू अनिरुद्ध, थैंक यू सो मच. सो मनी मैटर्स इज ब्रिंगिंग टू यू अ स्मॉल पैनल डिस्कशन on the topic of tax planning beyond ATC. So today we have with us two panelists, Amol Paranspe, who has done his MBA from NMIMS. He has 15 years of experience in investment planning and wealth advisory. He has shared his expertise in the financial planning and tax planning since 15 years. He is co-founder of Money Matters, and he was a panelist at Times of India Roundtable Conference in 2019 for investing opportunities. He has written a lot of articles on the topic of mutual funds, financial planning, insurance in the leading newspaper. So a very warm welcome to Amol sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Today with us, we have our guest of honor, a very renowned CA, Adit Shivalkar. He has done his CFP as well. He is founder of Adept Ally, a small business advisory firm based in Mulund. He has worked in corporates like Axis Bank, Kotak Mahindra Bank, and Big Four consultancy firm. He has shared his knowledge and expertise in this financial advisory for last 13 years. So a very warm welcome to both of you, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Charmi, for having me.
And so before starting, we are also live on Facebook. So would you like to say something to the audience?
I welcome our audiences. Amol, let Amol take it.
Yeah, okay. So thank you all so much for coming on a Sunday morning. And we really appreciate that. We have been receiving a lot of questions beforehand. And Charmi, I would like to take them one by one. And hopefully Adit and me will be able to answer most of it. And over to you, Adit.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining in on a wintry morning. It is a little difficult to, you know, pull yourself out of bed for a tax session. But I'm glad all of you are here, and you've given us an opportunity to, you know, clear your queries, clear your doubts about tax planning. So welcome aboard.
So we already have a few questions from our clients, from our friends. So we'll first address those. And if you have any question, you can put it in the chat box. We will take one by one. Okay. So to begin with, there is one interesting question from Mr. Shah asking, I am earning 12 lakhs. My wife earns 15 lakhs. How can I save maximum tax? So a similar question is there from someone else asking, how can I save the tax to optimum level? By both the question, what I understand is what they are trying to know. How can we save the tax to optimum level? So other than ATC, ATD deduction ke alawa, kuch way hai jisse hum log optimum level se tax save kar sakte hai. So, and also for the audience who doesn't know what is ATC, ATD, if you could just explain in one line.
Sure.
Yeah.
Shall I take it?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So, first up, I mean, most of us are aware about what ATC and ATD means. ATC is basically a laundry list of different instruments, the investment instruments. It may be insurance policies. Sometimes it is also about tuition fees for your children. Tuition fees meaning not the coaching classes. The tuition fee means the fees which we pay for university education in India. It also means contributions to Provident Fund, all of that put together. And for all these deductions, the upper limit all put together is 1,50,000 rupees per year. So if you invest 80,000 rupees in all of these instruments put together, it will only be 80,000. If you invest 2 lakh, all of this put together, you get 1,50,000. That's the way it works. It's what you invest and 1,50,000, whichever is less. That way you get as a deduction from your taxable income. ATD is deduction for payment of health insurance premium. And for the preventive health tests or health checkups that you have up till rupees 5,000, you can claim that as a deduction as well under Section 80D. Now, having set the tone about what ATC or ATD really means, the question, if I understood it correctly, is you know, what, how you can save taxes as a couple, right? So, of course, in India, returns are filed for every PAN number. So, आपका अगर एक PAN number है, आपका उस PAN number से corresponding एक return जाएगा. On the other hand, in certain countries, you know, they allow a mechanism whereby couples can file return together as a couple. But that's not the case in India, right? So every person has to plan for his own return individually. So a wife earning, say, 12 lakh rupees, she will have to plan for her ATC contribution, ATD contribution, and all other deductions separately. Husband earning, say, 15 lakh rupees, he will have to plan for it separately. So all put together, 150, 150, 3 lakh rupees investment, plus the ATD part of it will have to be invested individually by both. That's the way it works. One thing that comes to my mind is, in case husband and wife are purchasing a house for their family, then they can opt to service that housing loan together equally, 50-50%. That way, what will happen is, husband can claim housing loan interest deduction of 2 lakh rupees. That's the upper limit. And wife can separately claim 2 lakh rupees for what interest she pays. So that way, as a family, you end up getting a deduction of 4 lakh rupees from your family income, although it is reported individually into separate returns. So this is one thing that you know, comes to my mind quickly when someone asks me how, as we as husband and wife, can plan for our taxes. So this is one takeaway definitely that you can take. But otherwise, every tax planning measure has to be taken individually.
Thank you so much. I hope that aapka jo bhi query tha solve ho gaya hai, Mr. Shah. So, yeah, Amol sir, mujhe aapse ek question tha ki, jaise ki Aditya sir ne bola ki ATC, ATD mein 1,50,000 tak hum log kar sakte hain. To usme specifically koi fund mein kahan pe invest kar sakte hain? Like, what are the schemes available? What are the options available?
So, when we talk about ELSS funds, that is what you're talking about, tax-saver funds typically, those are called. As Adit told ki, there are a laundry list hai, ATC mein aap kya deductions le sakte hai, but definitely ELSS is one of the best funds, one of the best investment options to invest and take the deduction. Aap agar dekhenge, ELSS have been around for the past 15-20 years now, and the returns have kind of been in the range of, anywhere in the range of 12-20%. There are worst performing would be at about 12% and the best performing will be at 20%. Lekin agar kuch achhe funds ka naam dena hai, to name a few, I would say Axis ka ELSS fund kafi achha hai. Mire aur Invesco, for that matter, are very good in ELSS funds to invest, which are more than, say, about 15-16% returns jo aapko mil sakta hai.
Amazing. So actually, iske related a question hamare paas. So somebody is asking, do all tax saving schemes perform equally well? So aapne ye sab jo naam diye, so do they perform equally well, or is there any difference?
As I just mentioned, ki the worst performance has been 12%, jo jinhone perform kiya hai 12% tak return diya hai, and the best performing have been in the range of 20-22%. So average आप अगर return देखोगे ELSS schemes का, तो वो 15-16% है. Most of the ELSS funds are multi-cap, diversified funds होते हैं. So they are into large cap also, investing into mid cap also and small cap also. And fund manager typically, how he performs, the fund performs that way, I would say. So when you select any scheme, you definitely need to look at the fund manager कौन है, and then put your money accordingly, because finally he is the one who takes the final call ki kaun se stocks mein kahan pe kis time pe paisa invest karna hai.
Correct, right. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
So और एक इंटरेस्टिंग क्वेश्चन है विच बहुत क्लाइंट्स पूछते हैं हमको. सो इट इज, आई एम अ बिजनेसमैन एंड आई फोरसी रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ लोन्स फॉर एक्सपांशन इन नियर फ्यूचर. सो हाउ शुड आई प्लान फॉर द फ्रॉम दैट लाइक टैक्स पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, कैसे आई शुड बी प्लानिंग फॉर दैट.
ओके, इफ द पर्सन वांट्स लोन इन नियर फ्यूचर देन इज ऑलरेडी टू लेट. सो the advice that I typically give to people is you, if you are in business, आपको कभी ना कभी लोन की जरूरत पड़ने वाली है 100%. So you have to plan for an event, a final situation where you have to borrow a loan. At that time, जब प्यास लगती है तो कुआं नहीं खोद सकते. You have to start planning well in advance. And when I say well in advance, typically it has to be 3 years. आपको अगर आपके 3 साल के returns इस तरह से चले जाएं that your profit from your business is appearing to be, you know, increasing, that way you can buttress your case upon the banker that you're a good businessman and your business is increasing and to take your business to the next level, you want to expand and you want to invest in machinery or you want to invest in more working capital, whichever it may be. But आपको अगर आपके फाइनेंसियर को कन्विंस करना है कि आपको लोन दे, तो यू कैन नॉट हैव अ सिचुएशन वेयर वन ईयर योर इनकम इज 10 लाख रुपीज, द अदर ईयर योर इनकम इज अ नेगेटिव 80,000, थर्ड ईयर अगेन इट गोज अप टू 7 लाख रुपीज. इफ यू प्रेजेंट दिस काइंड ऑफ डेटा टू योर फाइनेंसियर विल डेफिनेटली रिजेक्ट यू. सो यू हैव टू स्टार्ट प्लानिंग फॉर इट वेल इन एडवांस, नॉट जस्ट कि आप रिटर्न में क्या दिखाओगे, बट ऑल्सो कि आप बिजनेस में आपको कहाँ कहाँ पे रिस्क लग रही है दैट योर अर्निंग्स विल फॉल डाउन, योर रेवेन्यू मे फॉल डाउन. यू हैव टू स्टार्ट टेकिंग यू नो काउंटर मेजर्स टूवर्ड्स एनी पॉसिबिलिटी दैट योर इनकम मे कम डाउन और योर यू नो रेवेन्यू विल कम डाउन. एंड फॉर दिस पर्पज आई विल गिव द एग्जैक्ट रिवर्स एडवाइस दैट यू नो पीयूष बंसल गेव ऑन शार्क टैंक सम टाइम बैक, स्टे अवे फ्रॉम सी. आई विल गिव द एग्जैक्ट रिवर्स advice, stay as close to CA as possible, maybe pay him 10,000-15,000 rupees, but ask him questions worth rupees 30,000-40,000. That way you'll get more bang for your buck also. At the same time, you know, you'll be able to build on your case, build on your profile of income, which is continuously increasing for 3 years. And that way you'll be able to impress your finances or your banker.
Totally agree with you, sir.
Adit, just to add to this, we have a lot of our salaried clients coming up to us and really asking us whether we do require a CA or not, whether we just have to file our normal return and which can be done online. So what advice would you give them? Do salaried people actually need a CA?
Okay. In case you're starting out your career, you know, you're at the early stage of your career, mid-20s, early 20s, stuff like that. You're earning, you know, 5-7 lakh rupees. Your, you know, deductions take care of themselves. Aapka PF contribution minus karke aapka income 5 lakh ki niche aa jata hai. When that, and you don't have any other income apart from salary and maybe bank interest. You don't invest in MFs. Don't have any capital gains, you don't have any rent coming up, nothing of that sort, right? These are the simplest kind of returns that you can service by yourself on an online portal like ClearTax or anywhere. But yahan pe complication jab aani chalu ho jati hai, aap actually aapka ek flat hai jo aapne rent pe de rakha hai, aapne housing loan le rakha hai, aapki salary actually 7-8 lakh nahi hai, 12-15 lakh rupees hai. And you start some part of your income goes into 30% tax bracket. Your HR asks you ki aapko kaun sa regime lena chahiye, aap decide karo. When all these complications start coming your way, wo baazi aapke haath se chhoot jati hai. Then you will have to, you know, get in touch with your CA and ask him that question rather than rack your head over it. Because finding these answers over internet is both easy and difficult because many portals give contradictory information. Ek hi baat pe do alag alag opinions aate hain kafi baar. And secondly, even if after doing a thorough research on internet also, sometimes you are having some residual doubts in your mind, right? So it's better to always go to a professional and get those doubts sorted once and for all. You save on your time a lot and you have definitive answers to your questions. So the you know summary of my answer. In case you have only salary and interest income up till say 6 lakh 7 lakh rupees and after deduction it comes to 5 lakh or less, you don't need a CA. But anywhere above that, you start requiring a CA.
So sir, right. So आपने जो बोला कि HR फिर पूछने लगता है कि new regime है, ये है वो है. So similar question somebody has asked. My HR tells me there is a new method of calculating tax. She's talking about new regime, of course. Should I offer new regime or stay with old regime? And आपने already बोल दिया कि मतलब ये businessman के लिए क्या होना चाहिए, new अच्छा रहेगा old अच्छा रहेगा या फिर also for salaried people, like दोनों के लिए क्या better रहेगा, what is the best option?
Okay, I'll just you know on a lighter vein compare government with Badshah Akbar, right? Used to ask all kinds of vexed questions and leave people perplexed कि अभी उसका क्या जवाब दिया जाए. And then Birbal had to step in and he had to solve all those kinds of questions. So here also, you know, government has asked this kind of a perplexing question. Aapko ek old regime to tha hi, of course, aapka 5%, 20%, 30%. They have also given you a new set of slabs, but they are not straightforward. Aisa nahi ki wo slabs aap simply dekh ke, अरे हाँ यहाँ पे 10% दिख रहा है, यहाँ पे आपका 5% से डायरेक्ट 20% है, तो न्यू रेजिम सीम्स टू बी प्रॉफिटेबल. ऐसा नहीं है. न्यू रेजिम में उन्होंने बोला है कि आप हाउसिंग लोन डिडक्शन नहीं ले सकते, आप ATC डिडक्शन नहीं ले सकते, आप काफी सारे जो चैप्टर 6 के डिडक्शन है वो सारे नहीं ले सकते, यहाँ तक आप स्टैंडर्ड डिडक्शन तक नहीं ले सकते जो आपके सैलरी में आपको 50,000 रुपीज डिडक्शन मिलता है. You know, so all these deductions you have to sacrifice for a discounted rate in tax. I mean, by discounted, I mean 20% ke jagah aapko 10% lene ka option milta hai. Now, suddenly, you know, you'll realize ki ye itni seedhi baat nahi hai ki naya regime aur old regime straight away compare kiya, ye advantages hai, ye kam advantages hai. It's not like that. So every time, you know, every person in different situations will need to go to either Excel if they are masters of calculating taxable you know income, or generally aise log kam rehte hain to the remaining mortals have to go to CA and you know load him with a lot of data ki bhai mera ATC deduction itna chala jata hai, mera PF contribution itna hai, these are my incomes, this is my housing loan deduction, and so on and so forth. And then you have to let your CA take that call ki aapko new regime achha pad raha hai ya old regime achha pad raha hai. And this question has to come during the year. So when I say during the year, if you suppose in the month of October or September itself, when you know that there is a new regime available and your HR starts talking to you about it, you have to project your income ki saal bhar mein aapka salary income itna hoga, maybe interest income roughly aapko pata rehta hai ki kitna hoga. You have to take that data to your CA, maybe have one sitting with him and project your income from both old regime and new regime and take a call at that point of time. Agar aapko pata chala October mein ki yaar there are many deductions, if I avoid those deductions maybe new regime zyada profitable pad raha hai, so maybe you will make those many investments less, though that is not an advisable you know way per se, but sometimes it works out for some people ki main utne ATC ke deductions kam karunga, unless I don't need them I won't do them. So then at that point of time new regime sometimes is profitable, but ye question generally aap during the year puche CA ko to wo aapko time bhi de payega, aapko acha answer bhi de payega, you will be able to plan your finances for the remainder of the year accordingly. So long answer short, old regime ya new regime ka I had done one video I remember with Money Matters last year jahan pe maine bola tha ki government ne ek question bahut perplexing pucha hai, aisa straight answer nahi de sakte. Straight answer is go to your CA, put him, give him your numbers and let him find the answer for you. That's my short answer.
So what I am understanding from this is basically salaried people ya fir businessman ke liye ek standard ye nahi hai ki new ke liye jao ya old ke liye jao, right? So it depends on person to person, not what you are doing. right? Amazing. ठीक है. So Krishnakant sir was asking how new tax regime is profitable. I hope sir ने already उसका answer दे दिया. Is your doubt clear, sir? Yeah. Thank you. So there is one more question, interesting yet funny. So what should we ask our CA? The question is, what should we discuss with our CA? What is the right thing to ask?
okay. So there are many people who may be going to a CA for the, I remember one recent client of mine, he's a youngster, maybe 21, 22 year old. He told me upfront on the phone call ke main kisi CA ke paas pehli baar ja raha hu, toh I don't know what to ask. And he was a derivatives trader. So he was very active in the F&O part. And then we had a freewheeling discussion. Ke bhai tu, matlab, how, what are you planning to do? How are you planning to take it forward and stuff like that? Certain things I came to know from that interaction. So in case you don't know what to ask to your CA, maybe start talking to him like you talk to a friend in a freewheeling manner. Give him your situation कि आपके family में इतने इतने लोग हैं, आपके इतना loan है, and you don't have loan, you have just starting out, आपके पास इतने इतने incomes हैं, or you are planning to do this, you are planning to do that. There are certain pointers that CA start picking up from that. That is one tip that I would give you. Be frank and be open to your CA. Secondly, of course, pick a good CA that you can open up to. पता चला कि so certain people are not very, good to talk to. ऐसा लगता है कि नहीं यार ये open up नहीं हो पा रहा हूँ. So you pick up a CA that you can open up to. Find some commonalities. कि हाँ ये अच्छा friendly बंदा दिख रहा है. Then you open up, and that's the first step towards really getting good advice. Because then if you interest the other person, you can start getting good advice from that person. That is for tip number one. Tip number two is, there are certain things that CAs definitely ask you. CAs ask you about your loans, specifically two kinds of loans, housing loan and education loan, right? Because both these things are, they are such that you can claim deductions on the interest payment of those deductions. So, ye dono questions, uska answer aapke paas hona chahiye, ya phir uske related questions aapke paas hone chahiye. कि मुझे वेगली पता है कि इसमें डिडक्शन मिलता है, बट थोड़ा आप मुझे बताइए. यू कैन आस्क दैट क्वेश्चन टू योर सीए. यू कैन आस्क क्वेश्चंस अबाउट द इन्वेस्टमेंट्स दैट यू हैव. कि जो इन्वेस्टमेंट मेरे पास है, हाउ टैक्स एफिशिएंट आर दोज इन्वेस्टमेंट्स. सर्टेन इन्वेस्टमेंट्स, आई विल गिव यू एन एग्जांपल ऑफ अनलिस्टेड बॉन्ड्स फॉर एग्जांपल, राइट? तो अनलिस्टेड बॉन्ड्स हैज इमर्ज्ड इन द लास्ट कपल ऑफ इयर्स as not that tax efficient an investment. Baki ye puri duniya ko pata hai ki FD is not at all a tax efficient instrument. Pura ka pura income aapka highest slab mein, matlab jo jis slab mein bhi aap ho usme tax ho jata hai, and capital gain to obviously hote nahi hai. Pura ka pura interest jo hai wo aapke slab ke hisab se tax ho jata hai. But in case you have certain doubts ki main pehle premature withdraw karu to kya, these are all these investment related questions you can ask to your CA. And it's okay even if you are not precise about asking questions. Your CA, if he's smart enough, he can get the gist of what you are asking, and he can answer you accordingly. So be frank, ask him investment and loans related questions. Maybe give him information about your financial situation. Ki aapko kaun se goals plan karne hain. Same advice that if someone goes to Amol also, these are the questions you should ask Amol also, because Amol can help you with a lot of goal planning, financial planning and stuff. So the similar information you can give to your CA, and you can expect your CA to give you some, value addition related advice.
Amazing, right? So, sir, आप अभी बता रहे थे कि salaried people है या कोई भी है, you require a CA. So there was a question. So there is a question. My spouse pays tax under presumptive method. So उसमें भी क्या CA होना चाहिए? मतलब वो लोग तो direct what they are asking is it a good strategy or whether declaring actual income after maintaining account book is a better idea? And do they require a CA for this? So what is your view on it? Yeah.
The situation here is a person, I mean, his or her spouse is into business, and that person basically takes a 50% deduction on his gross receipts or her gross receipts and declares the remaining part as business income in his or her return. Now, this is a good strategy prima facie, but over a period of time, what happens? Suppose you are working as a consultant in a corporate, or you are working maybe just as an advisor there, and you are working from home. It's a home business of sorts. Now, there are no clear business deductions here. You're working solo as a freelancer. You're working from your home. There are no much expenses that you can claim as deduction. But since you're going into presumptive scheme, you're trying to take advantage of it by declaring 50% only as income. Whereas otherwise, you would not have claimed anything. 100% of your income would be taxable. But because of presumptive income, you're getting that advantage. Now, with this situation, what happens over a period of time? It will not happen immediately. But over a period of time, what will happen is a gap will start showing between your assets and your income. So, wo kya raha hai ki aap 100 rupees ka income kama to rahe ho, ab declare 50 rupees kar rahe ho, taking advantage of presumptive income, presumptive taxation method. 50 rupees aapka taxable income hai karke aap income tax ko batao ki income tax aapki baat maan lega. बट आप इन्वेस्ट 100 का 100 रुपया करोगे, उस पर आप कैपिटल गेन्स कमाओगे ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, वो आपका पूल एक्सपैंड होता चला जाएगा. और ये आप साल दर साल करोगे, एवरी ईयर 100 का 50 ही डिक्लेयर करोगे, 100 का 100 इन्वेस्ट करोगे, तो देर विल बी अ यॉनिंग गैप बिटवीन वॉट यू शो यू अर्न एंड वॉट यू ओन. यू नो, इतना कमा रहे हैं, इतना ओन कर रहे हैं, ये इतना बड़ा गैप बनता चला जाएगा. एंड having disproportionate assets is also grounds for income tax to start scrutinizing you and maybe start even asking difficult questions to you. So is situation mein aap mat padho, try and keep that deduction real. So aapko accounts maintain nahi karne mat karo, kyunki uske liye aapko CA ki zarurat padegi. You want to do it yourself, you are on a tight budget or whatever, try and claim less deduction. Try, instead of claiming 50% deduction, maybe claim 70% or 80% deduction. Keep it as close to 100 as possible so that gap doesn't open up really fast. That is point number one. Point number two, as far as possible, keep a separate account, at least in your notebook, about aapka business ka kharcha kitna ho raha hai aur aapka iska kitna ho raha hai. Aapka personal kharcha kitna ho raha hai for all the common assets that you use if you're in a home business. Try and keep a score of what you are using. कोई एक specific room होगी आपके जहाँ से आप सिर्फ business कर रहे हो, nothing like it. But if it's a common room, you use it as your bedroom also, or your study room also, and you use it for your as your cabin also, you take your meetings, it becomes a little tricky, right? So ऐसे situation में generally मैं advice ये करूँगा कि if you are absolutely unable to separate your business and your home expenses, I'd suggest you start considering moving out of your home into an office so that you can keep a proper track ki aapka business ka expense kaun sa hai aur aapka ghar ka kaun sa hai. Try and maybe hire an employee, which will not only help you, delegate work, aapki bandwidth release ho jayegi, at the same time it is a deductible expense. So start having real expenses from your business in case you are really earning that much, right? And then if you have real expenses, then it would again make sense to maintain accounts, maybe in Tally, maybe in QuickBooks, or maybe in just Excel. You can do that and you can claim what is real, so that what you own, your assets, and what you earn, your income, they stay together, and there is no question for income tax department people to ask you.
Correct, right.
Adit, just to take this point forward, we always have this debate or discussion with our clients ki zyada tax bharna acha hai ki we pay less tax. I mean, that is always this is always in our discussions ki प्लानिंग करना है, पैसा ज्यादा इन्वेस्ट करना है, फिर टैक्स कम भरू, या हाउ डू वी डू इट? सो कुड यू थ्रो सम लाइट ऑन दैट?
ये दिस इज अ वेरी अगेन डीप क्वेश्चन. ओके, सो पेइंग मोर टैक्स और पेइंग लेस टैक्स टोटली डिपेंड्स ऑन व्हाट योर गोल्स आर. जनरली आपके जो गोल्स होते हैं वो ये होने चाहिए कि आपको एक वेल्थ बिल्ड करना है, राइट? नाउ लाइफ प्रेजेंट्स सर्टेन सिचुएशंस टू अस वेयर आइदर वी कैन पे टैक्स, रिटेन द रिमेनिंग अमाउंट एंड मे बी इन्वेस्ट इट गेनफुली समवेयर, or not pay tax and maybe invest in some tax saving schemes where in case we invest in that aapka tax bach jata hai but aapko thoda kam interest rate pe ya kam you know rate of return pe aapko investment rakhna padega. to wahan pe again aapko comparison karna padega ki what is profitable, tax pay karna profitable hai nahi pay karna profitable, invest karna in a tax saving scheme is more profitable. So these are the questions that you have to go to a CA with or to a financial planner with and let him, you know, analyze in Excel and give you an answer for that. As a rule of thumb, generally tax is a cash outflow as a rule of thumb. और जितना आप tax कम pay करोगे आपके wealth में उतना addition होता जाएगा, और जितना आप wealth में addition करोगे उसका compounding effect and then the impact that it will have on your wealth will be tremendous. But at the same time, sometimes paying taxes makes sense. Some time ago, I think Charmi asked me that question ki, you know, you have to, I have to apply to a loan, then what do I do? When you show increasing income, you have to pay increasing taxes also, right? If you are, you know, visualizing a scenario that you're running an income and maybe someday you will have to take a loan, it makes sense to start paying more taxes for at least 3 years. And show that your business is buoyant enough to merit getting a loan. So, ऐसे situations में it is generally more advisable to pay more taxes. Otherwise, it is generally more advisable to pay plan for paying less taxes. I would say plan for paying less taxes through legitimate means. This is a umbrella answer, but every situation is unique, so we'll have to analyze accordingly.
Right. So there is one more question. Can we set off? Can we set off short-term loss with short-term profit?
I'm assuming that the person is asking about capital gains.
Yeah.
That's the case. I think yes, you can.
Yes.
I would like to add to it, Adit. This is also asked in case of equity and debt investments. So. There is long-term and short-term profit or loss, and in both the cases. So we have a similar situation when we have our clients coming in. So if you could just add to it. Yeah.
Sure. Okay. So again, as a rule of thumb, short-term capital gains and short-term capital losses are mutually, they can be set off. Right. So it is always smart to keep a track of your short-term losses because you can farm them, you can harvest them to set off, take a set off with a current year's capital gains. That is part one. You can also carry forward these losses. And in case you don't have enough capital gains, short-term capital gains in this year, and suppose next year you end up making short-term capital gains, you can harvest those losses that you made last year, carry forward those losses to the next year, and knock those losses off with the next year's capital gains. That is also something that you can consider doing. So one addition to the questions that you can ask to your CA, mere losses maine kafi kiye, how do we you know, how much are those losses? I don't have a figure in my hand, but I know I've made losses. Let your CA figure it out, let him calculate and give you a figure. Secondly, report those losses in your income tax. Must do. Losses ka life mein kuch koi fayda nahi hota apart from taking, you know, set off later on with your actual gains. So at least if there is a silver lining to the cloud, take that silver lining. Report that loss in your income tax return. Take a set off in the current year or carry them forward for set off in the next year. So that's a short answer that I would like to give. Definitely, you can set them off with short-term capital gains, 100%.
मतलब लॉसेस से भी फायदा ले सकते हैं
जी,
एंड दैट इज द टैक्स इज द ओनली वे वी कैन डू
इट. एब्सोल्युटली
अमेजिंग. सो कृष्णकांत परब हैज अ क्वेश्चन. कृष्णकांत सर, ईपीएफ और पीपीएफ विड्रॉवल्स फॉर हाउस रिनोवेशन कम्स अंडर टैक्स.
Okay, so whether it is for house renovation or it whether it is for any other purpose, basically the rules stipulate about withdrawal from PPF or withdrawal from EPF. So to answer that question, from PPF if you withdraw, I think the withdrawals are taxable. Even for employees provident fund, in certain situations it is taxable. Basically, you have to take the data to your CA. There is this risk, and there is definitely this question ki bhai main mujhe iski zarurat hai. I need money for house renovation. Is withdrawal from PPF or withdrawal from EPF the best way I can, you know, fund this requirement with? Is the question that you can ask to your CA. So before you even take a decision to withdraw, just take a quick appointment. Sit on your CA's head, ask him about many things that you can do. He will also ask you certain questions. Ki aapke aur kya assets hai, apart from PPF, EPF, is there any other way in which you can fund that requirement? Your CA will give you a better idea. So don't risk touching your retirement savings, because PPF is a 15-year instrument generally used for, you know, funding retirement goals. Or long-term goals like children, marriage and stuff. And employees provident fund is again same. It is basically a instrument for funding retirement goals. I strongly suggest that you don't touch that. Government has created rules against withdrawal of such things, because government doesn't want you to touch your retirement savings. There is always some other way in which you can fund your short-term requirements. And for doing that, you have to go to a CA and ask him that.
So, Amol sir, if you could answer ke wo short term requirements match karne ke liye, if you have any view to it, ke what we can invest in, how can we achieve short term goals?
Ideally, as Adit said, you really need to plan for your goals, short term goal ho ya long term goal ho. If you have a proper plan in place, that is what we suggest all our clients, ki financial planning karna bahut zaruri hai. If you have a plan in place, you really know कि आप कितना आप save कर सकते हो, आप long term के लिए कितना save कर सकते हैं, short term के लिए कितना save कर सकते हैं. Definitely there are debt instruments which are available, which we typically suggest for short term goals, क्योंकि equity should ideally be used where your minimum 5-year horizon is what we tell all our clients. आप अगर इक्विटी में 2 साल या 3 साल के होराइजन से इन्वेस्ट करो, देन देर मे बी अ सिचुएशन वेयर यू कैन बी कॉट ऑन अ रॉन्ग फुट एंड मार्केट्स गिर जाए और यू वोंट बी एबल टू यूटिलाइज दैट मनी फॉर योर शॉर्ट टर्म गोल. सो प्लानिंग इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. फाइनेंशियल प्लानिंग करना बहुत जरूरी है. द अर्लियर यू डू इट द बेटर इट इज फॉर एवरीबडी.
सो The question, there is a question. हम लोग बात कर रहे थे अभी थोड़े टाइम पहले के टैक्स सेविंग फंड्स के बारे में. सो क्वेश्चन इज बेसिकली या सो द क्वेश्चन इज इफ आई हैव इन्वेस्टेड इन टैक्स सेविंग फंड्स एंड इट हैज कंप्लीटेड इट्स 3 years लॉक इन पीरियड, सो इफ आई रिडीम दैट अमाउंट विल इट बी टैक्सेबल?
ओके, सो आफ्टर द लॉक इन पीरियड इज ओवर, इफ यू रिडीम योर ईएलएसएस फंड्स, आई एम अज्यूमिंग द क्वेश्चन इज अबाउट ईएलएसएस फंड्स. After the lock-in period is over, you can definitely withdraw from your ELSS. And your amount that you had initially claimed as ATC deduction when you had invested in ELSS at that point of time, that amount will not be taxable, right? But on the other hand, suppose you had invested in growth option of an ELSS. Generally, people do that. People don't go for IDCW option. If that's the case, then there is a possibility that you have earned sizable capital gains. So suppose you have invested 1 lakh rupees 3 years before, and now your ELSS funds are worth 1.5 times what it was initially. So it is now worth 150,000 rupees. If that's the case, then 50,000 rupees is generally considered as a profit, or rather as a capital gain. And that capital gain is definitely taxable. So although that 1 lakh rupees which you had initially invested and you've completed the lock-in period of that is not taxable. But whatever profits you make are taxable. So you need to plan accordingly. You need to plan your exit. Yahan abhi exit karunga to kya mere paas losses hai set off karne ke liye iske saath. Agar aapke paas losses hai, then you can go ahead and you can blindly redeem and get that profit of 50,000. Knock it off against your capital losses or whatever other losses you have, which can be set off against capital gains. Generally, there aren't any. But ये set off वगैरह का सबका mathematics करके आप exit plan करके फिर उसके हिसाब से आप करो।
So ऐसा ही similar question है कि I have a lot of mutual fund investments which are due for redemption. Will it attract tax? So the answer is same, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
So redemption मतलब generally future FMPs रहते हैं, right? So FMPs होते हैं या फिर किसी person का कोई goal is coming nearby जिसके लिए उसने invest किया था, so he plans to voluntarily redeem. Answer is same. You have to plan your exit, right? And when you plan your exit, the tax impact is minimal. Take proactive steps क्योंकि tax मैं सब even मेरे business clients जो होते हैं रहते हैं मैं उनको भी ये advice देता हूँ कि tax planning is what you do before the year ends. Tax reporting is what you do after the year ends. आप return filing के time CA के पास आओगे और बोलोगे कि अभी मुझे tax planning करके दे. So that is impossible. He doesn't have a time machine. He cannot take you back in time and you know rectify certain mistakes that you've already made. उसका impact आप undo नहीं कर सकते. But if you go to a CA before you are thinking of entering into a transaction, that's when CA can really help.
So ये बहुत important advice actually. Yes. Because actually अभी सब लोग जागते कि यार tax plan मतलब tax file करना है, हम लोग को reports भी अभी मांगते हैं, like it's already too late.
Yes.
So it is very important advice. Thank you.
Correct. And one more point is for equity. Or equity oriented mutual funds, right? Because now somebody came up with the redemption of mutual funds. Suppose those mutual funds are equity oriented mutual funds. If your capital gain is up to 100,000 rupees, which is 1 lakh rupees, if it is up to that limit, then it is considered to be an exempt income. Because government had initially kept the whole of capital gains, long-term capital gains from equity or equity-oriented mutual funds as exempt. That was before. Since I think 2018 or 2017, I just don't recollect. From that year on, 2018. So from that year onwards, government changed the rules. They restricted that exemption limit to 1 lakh rupees, which means now whatever you long-term capital gains you make over and above 1 lakh rupees, they are taxable at 10% if it is equity oriented mutual fund or equity, and you don't get any exempt indexation benefit also on that. So make sure, again jaise maine kaha, to plan your exit. Maybe your CA will be able to fit all your capital gains within that 1 lakh ka basket, and you will not have to pay any taxes on whatever long term capital gains you make. And sometimes it may exceed, in which case you'll have to start thinking about harvesting your losses and locking them off. So all these considerations are important.
Right. So the next question is, one of my colleagues received a notice from the tax authorities for HRA claims. What I need to do to ensure I don't have to pay any tax on HRA I receive?
Okay. So I'm presuming that the person is basically asking from a preparation standpoint, right? Not from a response standpoint. So what does he have to do, or what does she have to do to ensure that she has answers to the questions asked by tax authorities when a notice comes along? That's the question. Now, what you do need is perfect documentation. What kind of documentation am I talking? HRA is an exempt allowance, but it is exempt to a specific level. What is that level? It is lower of three things. The rent that you pay over and about 10% of your rent, or 50% of your rent, or what you pay actual. That's basically the formula for calculating whichever is lower of these three is considered to be a HRA deduction. Now, you need to maintain your salary records, your salary slips, your Form 16. You have to maintain that assiduously every year. That is part one. Part two, and most importantly, you have to ask your landlord, if in case you do have a landlord and you have a rent agreement in place, you have to keep the rent agreement ready for reference. Plus, you need to keep your rent payment receipts also in your records. That way, you will be able to buttress your case that you are paying rent. And therefore, because you have paid rent, you are claiming deduction from it. Lower of the three, mein ek rent paid, actual paid bhi aata hai. तो उसका प्रूफ आपके पास रहता है कि भाई ये दीज आर द रिसीट्स एंड देयरफॉर आई एम क्लेमिंग डिडक्शन फॉर दिस. सो एचआरए के लिए इट्स अ गुड क्वेश्चन बिकॉज काफी नोटिसेस आई हैं. इनकम टैक्स डिपार्टमेंट ये भी काम करता है कि जिस किसी ने एचआरए का एग्जेम्पशन ले रखा है ना, दे डोंट गेट इनटू व्हाट रिकॉर्ड्स हैव बीन शोन एंड स्टफ लाइक दैट. दे जस्ट इशू नोटिसेस टू एवरीवन हु हैज क्लेम्ड एचआरए एग्जेम्पशन. And they put the ball in your court to prove that you have all the documentation in place. Otherwise, agar aapne HRA exemption return mein claim kiya tha and you don't have any answer to give now, government is free to consider that you have taken wrong deduction and then they can charge you interest and stuff like that. So, ye aise bhi tactics hai. Government aapke paas Akbar Badshah banke kaafi baar aata hai, asking perplexing questions. So, you have to have these two things at least ready with you. One is the rent payment acknowledgements from your landlord. If a landlord doesn't give you that, if he just gives you a WhatsApp pay, okay, received, that's not enough, right? You need to have something on the record on paper with his signature that I've received so and so amount for rent for this month, stuff like that. So, if you keep that in your records, month after month, your HRA exemption becomes bulletproof and it is something that government won't be able to reject.
Amazing. Right. So, we have a last question and aapko aur kisi ko koi question hoga, please put it in the chat box. So, we have last question for the day with me and it is very interesting. So, asking for a friend. He owns quite a few flats, many of which are not given on rent. He enjoys unlimited interest deduction on housing loan repayment, which I think is very smart. Can I do something like this to save the taxes?
I guess he has not met his friend for the last 3-4 years because in the last few years, the government has actually recognized that there are quite a few such smart friends who are investing in quite a few house properties which are taken on loan, right? And they are not even occupying them. And generally, pehle khel kaisa hota tha, main aapko just as a interesting ye karke batata hun. People who are in 30% tax bracket, they had very limited avenues. They still have very limited avenues to save their taxes, right? So they have to be really sure about the exempt income and the taxable income and so on. But pehle kya hota tha ki they had one avenue, which was housing loan interest deduction under Section 24. What they did was, apna khud ka ghar to hai hi, main self-occupied ghar mein rehta hun, self-occupied house agar mera, maine loan pe liya hua hai, to uska interest mein deduction le sakta hun, but the limit for that was 2 lakh rupees. The maximum limit, usse zyada aap interest claim nahi kar sakte ho ek saal. But there was a loophole, intentional or otherwise, kept by the government ki, maybe to promote real estate sector, that loophole was maintained. That in case you buy a second home or a third home or a fourth home, and you buy that home after taking a housing loan, then that interest is not subject to an upper limit of 2 lakh rupees deduction. So, agar aapka 3 lakh ka bhi, 4 lakh ka bhi, 10 lakh ka bhi interest agar aap pay kar rahe ho, servicing 3-4 separate loans to buy 3-4 different house properties, you could claim all of that as deduction. And as a result of that, agar mera income, I'm well within 30% territory, I have some 20 lakh ka income, and because I have a house property income of rather negative income, the interest deduction of 10 lakh rupees, मैं 10 लाख के नीचे आ जाया करता था तो मेरा 30% वाला पूरा निकल के आई यूज टू कम इन 20% रेट. दिस इज द काइंड ऑफ ट्रिक दैट पीपल यूज टू प्ले एंड दिस इज वाई दैट पर्सन मस्ट बी सेइंग दैट आई थिंक दैट इज वेरी स्मार्ट. At certain times, though, he doesn't even keep the flat on rent and he's kept the flat vacant. Now, government has recognized this loophole and government says that, you know, no matter how many house properties you have, for all house properties, you can claim only 2 lakh rupees ka deduction, all put together. Which means, now this loophole has been plugged in such a way that real estate does not turn out to be a tax efficient asset for you anymore. Real estate mein, now in case you borrow loan from banks and pay well above 2 lakh rupees as interest, wo well above 2 lakh wala aapko part carry forward karna padta hai aur agle saal mein uska deduction lena padta hai. But problem uska ye hai ki agle saal mein jaane ke baad bhi aapka loan to agle saal waise bhi chalu rahega to us saal mein bhi aap repayment karoge. तो उस साल का इंटरेस्ट चला इनकर हो जाता है प्लस आपने कैरी फॉरवर्ड किया हुआ और ऐसा करते करते एक दिन आपका जो कैरी फॉरवर्ड वाला इंटरेस्ट है वो लैप्स हो जाता है. यू आर नॉट एबल टू टेक एडवांटेज ऑफ दैट. दैट्स द ट्रिक दैट गवर्नमेंट हैज नो प्लग्ड. पीपल आर नॉट एबल टू टेक दैट एडवांटेज ऑफ दिस स्कीम स्मार्टली नाउ. सो टू आंसर द क्वेश्चन आई वुड एडवाइज नॉट टू बाय मोर फ्लैट्स देन व्हाट यू रिक्वायर just because you want to save taxes. You are better off investing in instruments like mutual fund where until you sell the mutual funds, you don't have to pay any taxes. And even if you pay taxes, it will be to the tune of long-term capital gain tax 20%, right? 20% with indexation or 10% without indexation. So 10% is low enough. You're doing all this to escape from the 30% tax hit that you get, right? So you are serving this purpose over here. Don't invest in real estate. And instead invest in such instruments which can give you this kind of tax benefit, one. Secondly, whenever you buy a real estate for investment purpose, make sure you put it on rent. Because agar aapne nahi bhi diya na rent pe, the government asks you to calculate notional house property income on the flat which you have kept under lock and key and report that income and pay taxes on. So aap chahe flat aapke paas rakho ya fir aap kisi ko bhade pe de do, aapko income tax to us pe pay karna hi hai. So might as well take real income rather than pay taxes on notional income and then pay tax on real income. I think that is a better strategy. So A, I don't find it smart that he invests in more than 3 or 4 flats. And B, I don't find it smart that he keeps those flats vacant. I don't find that also smart.
Correct. Right. Thank you so much.
Adit, one frequent question I forgot to mention. Sorry to cut you in, Charmi.
Sure.
काफी क्लाइंट्स को अप्रेजल्स या बोनस मिलता है दिवाली पे एंड पीपल डू कम टू अस कि यू हैव received so much amount and the commonest question asked is ki housing loan prepay kar do ya invest karu.
Okay.
So this is something like unplanned money that they have got kuch bonus aaya kahin se, they got a good amount or inheritance ka paisa kahin se receive hua, and then the most common question we are often asked ki housing loan repay kar do ya isko invest karu. So I would like to have your take on that.
Sure. I am generally of the opinion that you've taken housing loan partially to fund your home and partially to take care of your taxable income. When you prepay your housing loan, anyhow for housing loan principal repayment, you get a ATC deduction, but that is subject to an upper limit of 150,000 rupees, 1,50,000. If you prepay more than 150,000 rupees, you don't stand to get deduction of the principal repayment. And secondly, from next year onwards, you stand to pay less interest, right? Because you've paid off the principal, utna aapko interest kam padega. To wo jo deduction hai agle saal se, wo bhi kam ho jaye. So from tax perspective, if you ask me, maybe paying off housing loan is not such a great idea. But again, this depends on your circumstances. Certain people are planning to take some loan somewhere down the line for which they want to keep their finances tidy. And if they prepay certain loans, then the chances of them landing that loan increase. If that's the case, then that's a situation that you have to handle in consultation with your CA or in consultation with your financial planner. Second thing is, in case the question is not about housing loan, if it is about car loan, for example, then car loans are anyway not deductible. So if you prepay your car loan, you know, outstandings, that is a better strategy, because अगले साल से आपको इंटरेस्ट पे कम करना पड़ेगा, बट वो वैसे भी डिडक्टेबल नहीं है, तो एटलीस्ट आप कैश फ्लो तो बचाओगे. तो कार लोन्स हो चाहे दूसरे किसी टाइप के लोन्स हो, बट नॉट हाउसिंग लोन एंड एजुकेशन लोन. दीज टू लोन्स हैव टैक्स डिडक्शंस, द रिमेनिंग लोन्स डोंट. सो यू हैव टू यू नो प्लान अकॉर्डिंगली कि ये कौन से टाइप का लोन है और वेदर यू नो यू योर इनकम विल ऑब्वियसली रिमेन सपोज similar at a similar level, and you keep requiring deductions from housing loan and education loan. So for housing loan and education loan, you have to consult your CA. For remaining loans, you can take a call to prepay those loans.
So agar sir CA matlab tax ke point of view se na dekhe to bhi agar basic rule hai ki investment aapko karni hai karo, par pehle debt reduce karni chahiye jitna ho sake utna, right?
Yes.
So
yes.
From that point of view as well, we should prepay the loan jitna jaldi ho sake, right?
Correct. So give a priority list, keep a priority list ki aapke credit card dues hain, aapke personal loans hain, aapke car loans hain. These are the loans that you should target and you know determinedly reduce every year after year. These are not just not deductible, they are also expensive loans. Wo double digit bhi aate hai, aur credit card debt to it is notoriously expensive. So you have to prepay all those loans first. You know, whenever you get a bonus, prepay your credit card debt, prepay your personal loan, don't keep it outstanding. Prepayment penalty lagegi, lagne do, but prepay all those loans. हाउसिंग लोन की जहां तक बात है, मे बी प्रीपे ओनली एज मच एज द अनएग्जॉस्टेड लिमिट ऑफ योर एटीसी. यू नो प्लान इट इन सच अ वे कि इस साल आप इन्वेस्टमेंट थोड़ा कम करोगे, हाउसिंग लोन रीपे कर दोगे, तो एटीसी में आपका उसका जितना भी आप प्रीपे कर रहे हो उसका डिडक्शन मिल जाएगा. प्लान इट इन दैट वे.
करेक्ट. सो देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम कृष्णकांत सर. It's general question. How much percent people pay tax in India? What rest do?
Okay. How many Very percent nice. People yeah. pay taxes in India? Okay, super. So every year, I think Income Tax Department releases certain statistics, and in those statistics, we find that you know only maybe total 5 or 6% of population actually files returns. Right. And
shocking numbers.
Yeah. And those who pay taxes are maybe 2% or even less than that. So baki ke jo log hai wo to nil return wale, right? Jo 6% mein se bhi 4% may be nil return wale, 2% wagera. I don't have exact statistics with me right now, but this is the you know amount of tax returns that you have and the taxpayers that you have through income taxes. But ye main individuals ki baat kar. जो एक्चुअली सरकार की दुकान चलती है वो कंपनीज पे चलती है, एंड दैट्स वेयर यू नो द नंबर्स आर मच हायर. सो एज इट इज इंडिविजुअल से जितना टैक्स गवर्नमेंट को मिलता है, दैट इज मे बी वॉट 10-15% ऑफ गवर्नमेंट्स ओवरऑल रेवेन्यू. द रियल इनकम कम्स फ्रॉम कंपनीज, मे बी 30-40% और मे बी मोर देन दैट, एंड दैट्स वेयर गवर्नमेंट रियली रिकूप्स मेनी ऑफ देयर रेवेन्यू. The reason why people file less returns and pay less taxes is because India is for all, I mean, school se padhte aa rahe, India is an agrarian economy, the agricultural country. And agricultural income for political or non-political reasons is exempt, right? Agricultural income, even agar aap agricultural land rent pe bhi dete ho, toh even that is exempt. So because of that, there are so many people who get out of the tax, taxable pool as such. They come out of that pool. Agar aap agricultural income pe टैक्स लगा दोगे तो इकोनॉमिस्ट्स आर डिवाइडेड कि कितना टैक्स बढ़ सकता है. सम पीपल से कि नहीं यार आप बेसिक एग्जेम्पशन लिमिट में वैसे भी काफी लोग पकड़े जाएंगे तो वो वैसे भी निकल जाएंगे. ऑल यू आर डूइंग इज यू आर इम्पोजिंग अपॉन देम सम कंप्लायंस बर्डन कि आप रिटर्न फाइल करो. राइट, सो 5 लाख तक तो वैसे भी आपको रिबेट वगैरह मिलके आपको टैक्स तो वैसे भी पे नहीं करना पड़ता, तो इतनी आपको क्यों करना है, इतना कंप्लायंस बर्डन लोगों पे क्यों बढ़ाना है. एंड देयर इज अ ग्रेन ऑफ ट्रूथ टू दैट, बिकॉज फार्मर अगर 5 लाख रुपया अर्न भी करता है टैक्स तो उसको पे नहीं करना पड़ेगा, बट यू आर आस्किंग हिम टू फाइल योर रिटर्न, फाइल इज रिटर्न, तो उसमें से ज्यादा पैसा नहीं निकलेगा. बट आई मीन माई पर्सनल ओपिनियन इज जो एग्रीकल्चरल लैंड रेंट पे रहते हैं and those are sitting on vast tracts of agricultural land, those may be the people, you know, that can contribute to the tax payment. But as the things stand, it's just the businessmen, the salaried people, the landlords, those who are trading in equities or, you know, investing in real estate or selling real estate, those are the people who are actually funding this pool.
Right. एक्चुअली बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग इन्फॉर्मेशन था ये. वी डिडंट नो कि सिर्फ इतने लोग टैक्स पे करता है. लाइक अमेजिंग.
वी डू हैव सम स्टैट्स. आई थिंक 1.46 करोड़ इंडिविजुअल टैक्स पेयर्स आर लायबल टू पे इनकम टैक्स एंड टोटल ऑफ 5.78 करोड़ इंडिविजुअल्स फाइल देयर इनकम टैक्स रिटर्न फॉर फाइनेंशियल ईयर 18-19. सो दिस इज द इन्फॉर्मेशन दैट इज कमिंग आवर वे. समवन वाज काइंड एनफ टू शेयर दैट इन्फॉर्मेशन विद मी जस्ट नाउ. 4.32 crore individuals reported their income below tax bracket. ये जो मैं nil return वाले लोग बोल रहा था, that is the number. ये एक साल पुरानी information है. In fact, 2-3 साल पुरानी information है for financial year 18-19 की है. But it gives you a ballpark idea.
Right.
So on Facebook Live, So on Facebook Live, Mayuresh Dulas is saying very important session. Truly, it was like the information that we received today, the qualitative discussion that we had today. It was amazing. It added to a lot to my knowledge as well and to audience as well. So thank you.
I would ask anybody if anybody has any questions. We have taken, I think, most of the questions which were already listed out with us. Thanks to you who were apt with the questions much before the session started. But anybody has any questions, Aditya and me will be more than happy to answer it on the forum. And we are open to that.
From Facebook Live also, you can put it in the comment. We would love to answer.
I suppose, I think, Charmi, we are done with, we have answered most of the questions.
Yes, that are commonly asked, we've answered. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you so much. Yes, sir.
Like to add one quick point, something that I came across on quite a few occasions when I filed returns of people. Right? There are many people who invest in unlisted bonds. They are either... they are holding them right now. They plan to have them at some point. Those unlisted bonds have now become a little less tax efficient because in case those bonds are redeemed at a premium, then the long-term capital gains on bonds are 20%. Long-term capital gain tax is 20%. The problem is there is a small, proviso entered by the government I think a couple of years back, wherein government is basically denying indexation benefit to bonds, specifically the unlisted bonds. For listed bonds, obviously, there is always an option to take an tax rate of 10% without indexation. But for bonds in general, government has now said that only inflation index bonds will have indexation benefit. Remaining bonds won't have any indexation benefit. If that's the case, then for unlisted bonds, whatever premium you get on redemption, you stand to pay 20% tax and you don't get indexation benefit. So it is flat 20% without indexation. This is the only asset class in the laundry list of financial assets which is taxed at 20% without indexation. my point is, while investing in unlisted bonds, make sure again you consult your CA. In case you must invest in those bonds, make sure you don't have too much, you know, premium on the redemption. उसमें ना बॉन्ड इश्यू आता है तो पांच छह ऑप्शन आते हैं लोगों को, कितना टेन्योर, आपको इंटरेस्ट कितना चाहिए, प्रीमियम कितना चाहिए एंड ऑल दैट. टू सिलेक्ट द करेक्ट ऑप्शन यू हैव टू कंसल्ट योर सीए, ही विल एडवाइज यू कि ये सबसे टैक्स एफिशिएंट ऑप्शन है, अब उसको ऑप्ट करो. अल्टरनेटिवली इन्वेस्ट इन यू नो द डेट इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स थ्रू डेट म्यूचुअल फंड्स. दैट वर्क्स आउट टू बी अ मच मोर टैक्स एफिशिएंट वे ऑफ टेकिंग एक्सपोजर टू डेट एसेट्स. So that is one input that I wanted to give to all the potential investors, or rather the interested investors out there.
Right.
Just out of curiosity, I want to ask ki unlisted bonds ka ye aapne jaise bataya waise hota hai. So what about unlisted shares?
Unlisted shares mein government has not cancelled the indexation benefit yet. तो अनलिस्टेड शेयर्स में आपको 20% विद इंडेक्सेशन का बेनिफिट मिलता है. अभी आपको 20% नंबर देके डिस्करेज होने की जरूरत नहीं है, बिकॉज इंडेक्सेशन का मतलब क्या है कि मैं 5-10 साल पहले किसी शेयर में मैंने इन्वेस्ट किया था, 20 साल पहले इन्वेस्ट किया था, तो जो महंगाई का इन्फ्लेशन का रेट है उसके हिसाब से आई कैन एडजस्ट कि अगर 10 साल पहले 1 लाख रुपीज की कीमत कुछ थी तो आज के इन्फ्लेशन के टर्म्स से 1 लाख इज इक्विवेलेंट ऑफ व्हाट. इट में टर्न आउट की 10 साल पहले का 1 लाख इस पूरे आज का 2 लाख. तो आप जब 3 लाख रुपए में शेयर बेचते हो तो 3 लाख माइनस 1 लाख 2 लाख रुपीज टैक्सेबल नहीं होता, वो 3 लाख माइनस 2 लाख 1 लाख रुपए टैक्सेबल हो जाते. तो इट इज एज गुड एज यू नो 10% टैक्सेशन. इफेक्टिव टैक्स अगर आप देखोगे तो 10% बन जाता है, इवन दो यू आर पेइंग 20% रेट. 1 लाख पे आप 20% दे रहे हो तो 20,000 रुपीज आप टैक्स हो गए. तो ये चीज शेयर्स में अभी भी है. शेयर्स में दे हैव नॉट विथड्रॉन द इंडेक्सेशन बेनिफिट, बट फॉर बॉन्ड्स दे हैव विथड्रॉन बिकॉज़ दे वांटेड टू पुश द इन्फ्लेशन इंडेक्स बॉन्ड्स का प्रोडक्ट. तो ये एक चीज डेफिनेटली आई थिंक इट्स अ ग्रेट क्वेश्चन कि दूसरे इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स में भी व्हाट इज द टैक्स पोजीशन.
गॉट इट अमेजिंग. अमोल सर, वुड यू लाइक टू से समथिंग बिफोर वी एंड द सेशन? एंड आदित्य सर एज़ वेल.
Thank you so much, Adit, for this wonderful session. I hope we have done justice to today's session about tax beyond ATCA. And thank you, audience, for giving your Sunday morning to us.
Thank you so much to the audience, because it is, audience nahi hoti to this panel discussion would not hold any purpose, right? So thank you, audience, for giving your Sunday morning to us. And it's a chilly morning, just getting out of the bed. Like when I started, I said getting out of the bed itself is a pain. But I think you did that and you're here. Hats off to you all, you guys. And hope to see all of you plan your taxes in the coming year and, build your wealth. All the best for that.
Thank you so much, Adit sir, for being with us today, and we are looking forward to have more such session with you. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
You have a great Sunday. Bye bye.